guys. Welcome to the Cultivate and Keep podcast. Today it is me, Corey Haynes,
hey.
And Maximus.
What's up, Maximus? How are you doing today?
Bark, bark.
God, I was hoping you wouldn't do that.
How you doing, man?
Doing good. Doing good. I've got a lot to prepare for before Poland. And there's a lot to do. Also a lot mentally to prepare for. I think it's a 12-hour flight. And we're jumping ahead 9 time zones, so 9 hours. Actually, I don't know how many time zones that is. It's probably like 6 or something because we're going through the whole Atlantic Ocean. But yeah, it's going to be hard. I was telling you before, but I made a big boo-boo. And basically, the company is paying for the entire trip. So part of my negotiating was that I would only speak at the conference if they could fly Monique out too, because I told them it doesn't make sense for me to be away for so long, and it's a week, it's so far away, and you know, we would like to do it and have that experience together. And so like, that's fine, but we only have so much allotted for your travel budget, so if you can find a flight that fits in that travel budget, then you're welcome for your wife to fly too, and we'll figure out all your, you know, pay for all your hotels and car and food and whatever. So I was like, cool. So I was looking for flights, and I had the little like price tracker on in Google. And then one of the days, you know, it was pretty low. And then I got a notification from Google that said that the price was probably going to go up. I think it said by like 50%, in like 9 hours. And so I was like, oh, okay, I should probably book it today. And then I forgot about it, and I went to go play basketball that night. And then when I got to the gym, I remembered, and I was like, oh crap, I need to go check. And so I checked, and it was like in less than an hour, it's going to jump up by, there's like an 80% chance that it's going to jump up, you know, by a certain amount or whatever. And I was like, oh shoot, I need to do it because, otherwise it might be outside of our travel budget. We'd have to pay for whatever is outside of that. And, and then like all the guys were like, dude, what's, you know, what are you doing? Like, we're going to start and play. Why aren't you here? And, like, get up, let's go. And so I booked the flights really quick. And what I didn't realize was that I accidentally put it under Monique's married name instead of her maiden name, because her maiden name is what still has her passport. And so we wouldn't be able, basically if we showed up, we wouldn't have been able to fly at all. So I was like, okay, well, I'll just go call the company. We booked through Expedia and we'll have them change the name. So I called them up and I was like, hey, I just need to make a quick, you know, I made a mistake. I booked under the wrong name for my wife. We just need to change it really quick. And I just need to change it from her married name to her maiden name. And he's like, oh, okay, sir. Well, like, well, let me talk to the airline, whatever. So he calls me back and he's like, well, sir, we can make the change, but unfortunately the airline has a policy of if you do a name change, it's going to be $250. And I was like, oh my gosh, $250 for a name change. Like, it seems, I don't know if that's like a common practice, but that would also come out of my pocket. You know, I'm like, I'm not going to ask the conference organizers to pay for, you know, kind of my mistake. And so, I was like, dude, there's no way, like, we're not paying that. Is there anything else you can do? And he's like, no, well, let me call them back one more time. So he called him back and he's like, no, sir, unfortunately they have a policy, because we'd have to change the last name. And it's a name change. Technically it's $250, but if it was just a name correction of like, maybe like a couple of letters in the name, then it would only be $25. And so, oh, I was like, okay, well, thank you. Appreciate it. So I hung up, called back, got a different person, and I said, hey, hello, I just have a quick thing I need you to help me with. I need to make a name correction for my wife's name on the flight ticket. So she's like, oh, okay, that's, you know, very nice, I'll help you out. Called the airline. She's like, okay, sir, well, we can make the name correction, but it's gonna be $25 if I can get your permission.
Boom.
And I was like, yes, please do it right now, like, I'll read you my credit card number, just please charge it.
Awesome.
And so anyways, got it all figured out, but lesson learned.
$25 down the drain, huh?
Yeah, dude, 20 was a deep hit, but I was glad to pay it just because $250 would really be a bummer.
Yeah.
So lesson learned: don't make a mistake on your flight tickets. But also, the terminal, it was just crazy. Like, just the name. Yeah. Like, if you ask for a name change, $250. If you ask for a name correction, $25. So
yeah,
sometimes it pays to just be a little bit persistent.
That's funny. I was telling Corey that beforehand. That's kind of like, when I was younger, at GameStop, they had some kind of policy, like if you opened a new game, I forget what it was, but you open a new game, like you couldn't get your money back, but there was some, like, I think you got store credit, I'm not sure, but there was like some like loop around like with it. I remember like all the time, me and Timmy and Tia would always do it and like buy a game, play it, beat it.
You guys had a whole system
going. Then return it and get our money back, and like basically we invested our initial like seed money and just like, you know, turned it over for every game we played.
Yeah, you'd have a game for like 2 weeks and then you would like, you'd beat in like a rush to beat it because then you knew you had to return it so you didn't have to pay again. Yeah.
What can I say? I've always been a young entrepreneur. So
that's right. Yeah. Arbitrage.
It started young.
Leave it to Jeremy to make a GameStop reference or share a GameStop story.
It's okay. No shame.
That's right. No shame at all. Well, I'm excited to be a talk. I like this subject for today. Every opportunity has a shelf life. What was the kind of the impetus for this topic of discussion for today?
I don't know. I was just thinking about that. Something that I heard Mike Van Meter say a couple years ago. And it just kind of stuck with me. And I think why I was thinking about it, because right now, with me and Connie, just in some like a season of making a lot of decisions and kind of some new stuff coming. And so
making those moves.
Yeah, we've had some exciting stuff come up that we're not ready to share yet, but we will soon. But yeah, I mean, as stuff has come up, we've kind of felt like, wow, this is a really great opportunity as we can see it. And we know we hope it's going to turn out well. Like, should we do it? And like in our discussion, like typically how it works is Connie moves quick and I move slow. So like if we have an opportunity, like Connie will look at it within, you know, honestly within like seconds, we'll make a decision, yes or no. And I'm the kind of person, like no joke, like I need days, if not weeks.
Weeks,
to,
yeah.
Easy probably. To think about stuff.
Months, maybe.
And so we had a few cool things come up. You know, one of them actually that we've talked about is that new company that we just took over. So now we have... we essentially had two companies that we merged into one, and that was like another example of like, look, we had this opportunity, we had, you know, like an opportunity to make a decision, and that was when Connie was like, you know, yes, let's go, and I was like, whoa, give us time,
yeah.
And we ended up doing it, but you know, throughout that part of the discussion we had was like, Connie was like, look, like you have to decide, like you got to go yes or no, because if you don't, like we're gonna miss out. And then, so that kind of happened and we ended up doing it. But like right now we're kind of having some more opportunity in front of us, and it's kind of the same deal. Like I want to take my sweet old time. Connie's like, let's go. And so it's kind of brought this back up. So
yeah,
kind of the long story of why I want to talk about it.
Yeah, no, I think there's definitely some truth in there. And I don't know if we really think enough about like the things that are before us, like the opportunities that are maybe, I feel like for me, I'm probably in the same boat as you, and that it seems almost more like a chore than it does like, oh, I have to make a decision. Like, and now it's much of like a burden instead of like, you know, let's go like take this thing and let's just go do it. You know, where someone like Connie is just like kind of a go getter, just make the decision and go with it. But I definitely, well, why do you feel like you do hesitate in some of those decisions or opportunities that are in front of you?
I've always kind of felt like I can't come back from like a poor decision. My whole life I felt that way. And I know it's not true. Like I know, like, I don't know, you think of like your worst case scenario, like that could happen in life. And if as long as you survive it, like physically, like you're still alive, like there's a way to come back. Like assuming you're not in jail for life, right? Like besides those two situations, like what can you not come back from, right? I mean, if like anything, you can pretty much like make a return on. But in my mind, that's not the case. In my mind, like, you know, if I make one bad decision, like everything I've worked for is gone. Mm-hmm. And I know it's not true, but for some reason, that's just in my head. And so that's kind of why, like, I, you know, again, with big and small decisions, I will easily just like feel like, oh, I want to shy away from this and like not make a decision.
Mm-hmm. That's funny. I feel like, go ahead.
I was going to say, like, I'm speaking like to the extreme side of me right now. Like, I think I've definitely grown in this a lot over the last year.
It's true.
I actually, yeah, for the most part, I feel like I more lean towards like liking opportunity and decision now, but, I wanted to kind of speak from that perspective of like being super like against it, you know, cause a couple years ago I like hated this stuff. So,
Sorry. I was going to say, I feel like I'm a little bit different in the way of, I feel sometimes I'm really conservative with like the things in front of me because it's almost like I want to wait out for something better later that I don't know. And I don't want to miss out on like the other thing, you know. It's like, what's that game where, it's like one of those like TV, like what's it called? Deal or no deal, where he's like, do you want door number one or number two or number three?
Suitcase, bro. Case.
That's right. Okay. And it's like door number two is almost always like the winner.
Hold on, back up. His name is Howie.
Howie? Yeah. Is that what it is?
How funny is that? I just watched it when I was in Oregon a few months ago, and I thought it was so funny. Like, oh, Howie is his name.
Howie. Yeah, it's one of those names that you don't hear like with our generation. Yeah. It's very
Howie.
Last generation.
No offense if your name's Howie.
No, no offense at all. In fact, I think it's pretty dope, but it's just strange for us probably. But I'm a very much like door number two kind of guy. Like, okay, well, if I do this thing and I put all my chips on the table for this one bet, you know, does that mean that I miss out on the next thing? You know, I'm going to feel dumb about this one thing and I kind of cash in for. And I always like want to like, you know, look at all the angles and do all the, you know, take my time to look through everything and think through every scenario and maybe even like wait it out for a little bit to see if there's something better. I feel like especially for like big, you know, purchase decisions, you know, like we'll be walking through a store and Monique's like, oh, this looks great. Like let's buy this one. I'm like, well, what if there's a cheaper one on Amazon? Yeah. And like, what if there's a cheaper one from Amazon on another site? And like, what if they're going to run a sale on it next week? And why don't we just give it a week and come back to it? And, but in reality, that's almost never the case. Yeah. But this idea of, you know, every opportunity has a shelf life. It is true that at some point you do have to make a decision, right? And there's some things like we've been kind of, this is my fault. It's actually a really good example, but I've been procrastinating in buying a new trash can. This is like total hashtag adult life kind of things. But, I'm like trying to figure out what's the best trash can. I'm like, wait a second. There's no best trash can.
Trash can.
But not everything is like a trash can where you can just like wait it out forever. Right. Like there are some things that do have a shelf life, and then you do have to make a decision. Otherwise it's going to pass you by to the next guy. Hmm. You had some interesting examples. You want to go through those?
Yeah. So I was looking up like famous people that like missed opportunities. Kind of like what I looked up.
It's a sad thing to search.
I was just curious like what I found. And like the first article I read was this one. I don't know who this actor is. I know his name. Like it's familiar, but
You don't know who it is?
I can't picture him.
Come on.
Sean Connery? Who is that?
Okay, he was the best James Bond, first of all.
Oh, wait.
But he's also the guy that talks like this.
Yes. And okay, I know it is.
Yeah, he's very like manly man, suave. Yeah,
I recognize the name, just not like his face.
Okay.
Anyway, this guy, he missed out on $400 million by taking the role of Gandalf in Lord of the Rings. When it first started out, he was promised 15% of the box office sales, but it said that he turned it down because he did not understand the script, which is crazy. $400 million.
Oh, my gosh. Gee, wait, 15% of anything. I mean,
you take.
Yeah, what the heck is he thinking?
Yeah.
That's like, those are like gross, that's like gross revenue too. It's not even like how much they profit from it.
Yeah.
That is crazy.
It said, yeah, worldwide box office receipts.
Oh my gosh. And Lord of the Rings ends up being like one of the most iconic series and most successful movies ever.
Yeah. Next one was 12 publishers turned down Harry Potter. It's crazy. Jeez. I don't like Harry Potter, but
you don't? Are you serious?
It's obviously like it's big time, but 12 publishers turned them down.
Yeah, that's crazy. I've heard that before, cuz now, I mean, obviously it's like, I think it's there's like this little like I think it's like a is it a GIF or a video? Basically, someone like basically matched up like all the most successful movie series ever. And I think Harry Potter was like number two or three.
I know it's like up there
next to like some of the Marvel series, or there's another one. I forget what it was, but yeah, dude, that's pretty crazy. Hmm. They could have made it big time.
Yeah. Steve Jobs is his old boss. Had an opportunity to invest $50,000 as seed money in Apple. And he turned it down.
That's right.
And if he would have done that today, that would have been an equivalent value of $480 billion.
Wait, $480
billion.
Oh, my.
$50,000 would turn into $480
billion. Holy mackerel.
Dude, that one, I was like, whoa.
Oh, my gosh. Wait, I didn't know he was the founder of Atari. Wow. Okay, well, he made it big time anyway, so now, I feel super bad for him.
What is Atari?
Atari was like the first like game console.
That's what I thought. Okay.
Yeah. Come on, dude. You're a gamer,
easy,
bro. You
gotta pass gamer, bro.
Okay. All
right. Take it easy now.
Okay.
Ronald Wayne, he was Apple's third co-founder. He sold 10% stake of his share of 10% stake in Apple for $800 2 weeks after it launched.
Oh my gosh.
He got $1,500. What does it say? He got Oh, if he would have kept it, it would have been worth $40 billion today. So $800 for $80 billion because he didn't hold
out. Okay, $800. Like, he must have been in a dire situation, mm-hmm. or he's just plain stupid because, yeah. Oh, my gosh. Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
So there's more we're going to read, but the thing I wanted to, like, point out was kind of what I struggle with, like, with these guys, right? So every one of them had its opportunity. Looking at it now, it seems so obvious. Like, well, duh. Right. Like, you know, was that the big one was 50,000 for $480 billion. Like, you look at that and you read it and you say, well, wow, that guy, you know, how dumb was he to not take it? But in the moment, he had no idea. This was a guy that worked for him who had some crazy idea that he didn't want to put. You know, at the time, 50,000 was probably a lot of money for him. And so what I want to communicate is, like, how do we know? Like, when we're looking at opportunity in front of us, like, yeah, we have a limited time to make a decision, but how do we know if this is going to be a good or a bad decision?
Right.
Obviously, you know, we don't know, right? We don't have a guarantee yes or no, but I think, like, it's interesting to look back at this stuff now and kind of see it. But yeah, that's kind of what goes on in my head. Like, wow, if I do this, like, let's say, you know, I put in $50,000 on this guy, what if it goes terribly wrong and I lose 50,000? Yeah. The upside is, oh, you know, you could get $480 billion, but...
Yeah, it's sort of like the hindsight is 2020 idea of, like, you know, of course you can look back on anything and then, like, it it seems obvious, but at the moment it doesn't at all. I have some thoughts on that in a second, but I thought it was interesting to look at some more practical examples of, like, what would happen, for example, if you invested $1,000 into these stocks 10 years ago. So this year is 2019. This was 2009. I think actually each one of these is comparing June 1st, 2009 to June 1st, 2019. So if you, and this is funny too, because see 2009, we were freshmen. We were just going into our freshman year of high school. So there's no way that we could have, right? But let's say that we did invest $1,000 in each one of these companies. If we invested $1,000 into Salesforce in 2009, we would now have $15,950. If we did that in Boeing, we'd have $9,853. If we did it in Starbucks, we'd have $10,650, so it's 10 times return. If we did Amazon, it'd be $22,760. Nike was $5,000 and $5,410. Apple, about $11,000. And then Netflix, the surpriser of them all, $1,000 10 years later turned into $61,000, which is pretty crazy.
That's crazy.
I feel like that's especially, you know, a lot of guys, surprisingly, like, no girls, I'm not really sure why, are really into, like, stock picking, you know, and, like, investing in the stock market. Mm-hmm. But 10 years ago, obviously, also was, like, right after the crash of the economy and the stock market. And so everything was at all-time low. And so obviously your money's going to go a long way when you have a 10-year bull run. But also, like, again, hindsight's 2020. Like, Salesforce is a multi-billion-dollar company. Boeing is huge. Starbucks, Netflix, Amazon, like, Apple. It all seems super obvious. But also, what I didn't list here was that there was a lot of other stocks that were like $59 or like.
Well, I was gonna say I'd be curious to see ones that, like, were negative. You know, that lost.
Yeah, exactly. There was a lot that went out of business, or that lost a lot of value. Not very many of them, like, went negative or went completely under. Like, most, the majority of them were like, you know, your $1,000 would now be $649, or it'd be $500 or $300. And there was a couple that it was like, you know, $50, and basically you lost everything. But also I wonder, like, you know, how many, for Sean Connery, for example, like, how many roles was he offered, and, you know, how many kind of, like, sci-fi fantasy things had he been seen before and be like, oh, none of these turned out to be right. Or none of these turned out to be big. Like, why should this one be big?
Yeah.
And so it is tricky. Like, I think for me, like, that's the big thing is, like, which kind of, if you only have so much time or money, or, like, if you only have so much to put into something, like, which ones do you put it in, and how do you decide that?
Yeah. I mean, I wish I had the answer. I don't, but, you know, thinking about it, like, that was one of my questions too. Like, if looking back at this, or, like, kind of looking at your own life, like, you know, you have opportunity most likely in front of you. Like, so I think, like, think about, like, what's in front of you, like, what can you do? And I was going to ask, like, how do you go about, like, you know, evaluating your decisions? How do you go about saying yes or no? How do you know, again, like I said before, how do you know what's going to be a fail or, like, a big win? And I think the reality is, like, you don't know the answer, but you can have a process of, like, deciding, again, the yes or no. I was curious, like, for you, like, what steps would you take in making, like, a big decision, whether it's an investment or, I don't know, career change or just some, like, you know, big decision? How would you go about doing it?
Yeah, I don't know if I feel like we've talked about this before, but one of the things I think has been super helpful for me is, like, looking at the upside versus the downside. And so basically, like, you know, like, how much could this be great for me? And, like, how much risk is involved, mm-hmm. too? And I think by default, we kind of always overestimate the risk involved in something, mm-hmm. of, like, oh, I'm going to invest in this business or in this stock, and it's going to drop to zero next week. I'm going to lose all my money. And it's, mm-hmm. like, that happens, you know, 0.01% of the time or something. It's, like, yep. It's actually very rare. Like, the risk isn't as great as you think. For example, when I was considering taking the job with Barometrics, my current job, you know, I was going through this kind of same thing, right? Because essentially every month I was getting new stock options in Cordial, and so taking the job at Barometrics would mean that I would cut my stock vesting short. So I would only basically vest almost half of my stock options. So I was trying to think, like, well, am I, like, giving up a ton, or am I gaining a lot? You know, like, basically what's going to happen here? Mm-hmm. And essentially what I kind of realized, and the reason why I made that decision, was because I felt like the upside of joining Barometrics was far greater than the downside of missing out on those stock options, or like it not working out, not being a good job, or not liking it, not doing well, for example. And I think that's a good place to start, is just to kind of look at really, like, what's the risk of me, especially for an opportunity in front of you. Like, if you have like to buy something, to invest in something, to do something, to change your job, whatever it is, like, look at the downside and then look at the upside. And if the upside far outweighs the downside, it's almost always a good decision to do that, you know?
Hmm. I've learned a few things about this, I feel like, over the last couple of years. And one of them is kind of surprising, which you probably wouldn't expect. But for me, I've actually, like, narrowed down. So first thing for me is advice. I get advice from people. But what I want to say is I've narrowed down, like, the span of people that I talk to. Because before it was like there wasn't, like, one specific person I would, you know, meet with or ask advice from. It was literally, like, everyone that I talked to that I somewhat respect, I would ask, you know, I would ask their advice, right?
Yeah.
And I feel like that's just trouble, because you get so many different opinions and views and perspectives. It's super hard to, like, you know, weigh everything and kind of, like, filter it. And it kind of, like, just clouded my judgment in my mind. And so more recently, me and Connie have, like, narrowed kind of who we get advice from, like, for a few people. And so what we've done is every, like, major decision, we go through them, whether it's good, bad, hard, ugly, like, they get to hear it first. And I think that's been super helpful. Like, I'm not saying we only talk with one person, but I'm just saying it's less than, you know, dozens, right?
Right.
So that's been super helpful. So that's kind of just in general. But for another thing I was going to add was, like, for a financial, like, just anything regarding money, I've looked at, like, okay, what is the worst that could happen? And kind of like you're saying, like, let's say everything goes bad. Like, where do we land? Where do we end up? Is that better? You know, is that better or worse than the possible upside? That's kind of, like, one way to look at it. And also kind of, like, again, if it goes bad, like, what is our, like, exit strategy? How do we get out of this? And what's that going to look like? And so if we can survive those both, like, smoothly, then we do it.
Yeah.
So
you tell me how comfortable you are with talking about this, but it's sort of a recent thing, right? Because when you purchased the second business that merged into now your one business, that was kind of the exact thing that we talked about, was like, you were kind of going through it, and basically we were kind of like, well, let's say, like, what's, like, the lowest or, like, the worst that things could go, and basically figured out, like, actually wouldn't be that bad, or, like, we could survive, or, like, at least make it work for a few months and then have time to kind of, you know, relook at things. But I think even then, like, if it even went down to zero, like, it still wouldn't, you know, be the end of the world, right? It's, you lost some money at the end of the day, but, like, it's not like you are out of a job or your business crashed or anything like that.
Yeah. So before we hit that company, we said, okay, what are all the costs, like, the monthly costs that we have? And then we said, kind of, where are we at? And then if we add this, like, what are the, like, marginal increases that's going to add? It's kind of what we looked at. And then we kind of realized, okay, like, yes, it's going to bump certain things up, but we looked at a, like, you know, for example, one thing that bumped up was like a warehouse, right? So we had a warehouse. It was really small. It was not enough space. And so we knew we needed a bigger one, but we didn't really, we couldn't, we didn't feel like we were ready to get into like a bigger lease. And so when we had this other company, we were forced to get into a bigger lease. And so that was kind of one situation where, like, okay, like, what are we paying now? What's the marginal increase? Like, it wasn't that much. And we kind of realized, okay, if we do that, that means we'll have to do, you know, X amount of jobs more per month to make up for it. And the reality was, like, that benchmark we set was, like, a very conservative amount. And so we kind of felt like, okay, like, you know, that's one of the worst case scenarios. We can do that. And then we kind of said, like, let's just say this fails. Let's just say we can't do anything. We went to go sell everything and try to get our money back. Like, we were comfortable with, like, the potential loss that I could have had. So that's kind of why we did it.
Yeah.
And so far, it's been great. One thing we've done different this with this company is that we're tracking, like, every... We're tracking all of our returns, basically. So, like, every product we sell or we rent, like, I'm tracking, basically, like, the return on it. So...
Like, how many times it's been rented and for how much?
How many times it's been renting. So now we have, like, I have, like, a software to where every inventory item we have, I can look at, like, what revenue it's brought in, which is super helpful and cool. Mm. And also, basically, like, our investment in this new business, like, what is this separate... I know we merged them both into one, but we're saying this new company, what has this brought in, like, year-to-date so far? And so we're tracking all that. And so I can tell you, and I can say right now, kind of, our return so far and all that. So it's been super good.
But also, when you kind of looked and said, like, okay, you know, based on like, how this business would fit into our other business and all the things we can improve, all the work we can put into it, basically you also figured out, like, the upside is actually really great. Mm-hmm. And if you even get close to that, then it's going to far outweigh any sort of risk of, like I said, that you're comfortable with. And so it almost, not that it was like a no brainer, but it felt kind of like you'd be missing out on a lot
too.
Yeah. Possibly.
One thing we did was we looked at, okay, so we took her revenue, the company we took over, we took their revenue for the last 3 years and we said, like, what's the overall average? And so we kind of did the math. So we took that average and we added to what we're earning now. And we said, okay, let's just say, like, this continued to trend, like, as is. Because with the company we took over, the last 3 years have all gone upward. But we said, let's just say this year, you know, was just, like, it maintained. Let's say it even went down a little bit. If that were the case, even with all of our, like, marginal increase of costs for taking on a new company, it still would bring in more profit. So, like, numbers-wise, it made sense. I heard in a podcast the other day, someone said, like, anytime you're making, like, a big financial decision, do the math, like, you know, because it's easy to get emotional. It's easy to, like, kind of get in your head. But they said, just straight up, just do the math. If it makes sense, like, on paper, then do it. Like, you know, that will take away all of, like, your doubt and whatever. And so with this situation, like, yeah, it was kind of a no-brainer for us. But at the same time, like, we did the math and we, like, definitely had made an educational decision and it all made sense.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. One of the things go ahead.
One thing I want to add was even after doing that, it was still hard. Like, it was still scary. It's still like...
there's still risk
involved.
A lot
of doubt. I had, like, a lot of nights where I didn't sleep well, and I would wake up in the night thinking about it, stressed out. And even now, like, it's gone well, but, like, it's still, like, pressure and still, like, an investment. And so I was going to say, like, no matter, like, if the numbers make sense or not, I know right now we're talking, like, financial stuff and investments, but, like, anything in life, like, if it makes sense on paper, right, whether it's, like, a, you know, relational thing or whatever, like, it can still be hard, and that's okay, you know? That's one thing we've realized, like, this one made sense for us, but it's still, like, been a scary leap to take. And I don't think, like, if you have, you know, those type of reservations or fear, that doesn't mean don't do it. You know, I think that's just part of life.
Yeah And those thoughts are there to, like, help you process it.
Gauge
and go
it,
through
yeah.
it, like, filter. If you didn't have any fear about it, it's like either too good to be true or you're not kind of, like, challenging yourself or thinking big enough. One of the things I've been trying to, again, I think I sort of prefaced it a little bit before, but I'm more of the, like, well, what if there was, I don't know, another business opportunity later, and now all your money is tied up with this first opportunity and you feel dumb. But most of the time, that's not the case, and that whatever is in front of you is usually, if it seems like a good thing, it is a good thing, kind of. James Clear, the author of Atomic Habits, one of the books we highly recommend. I think we did a book review on it too, right?
Mm-hmm.
A few, probably many episodes back now. But he just published this on Twitter. He said, most failures are one-time costs. Most regrets are recurring costs. The pain of inaction stings longer than the pain of incorrect action. So basically, a lot of people get caught up in, like, well, what if I do the wrong thing? Or what if this is the wrong move? Or what if this is actually a bad opportunity? And so they let it pass by, right? But normally, that actually comes back to bite you, because it probably was a good opportunity. Mm-hmm. You might not even know, but like the regret of not doing it usually is like a lot more painful, and like the kind of the regret, like of, you know, looking at the stocks, right? And if you were thinking about, you know, investing $1,000 into Netflix, and you're like, well, like what if it all goes down to zero and I really need this $1,000 for, you know, maybe this other stock that I'm thinking about, I'm going to hold out a little bit longer. Right. And then 10 years go by and now you're still thinking about that stupid stock that you could have bought 10 years ago, you know? So like kind of, I've been just kind of thinking about like default to action, you know, like make the most of something, you know, and if there is an opportunity in front of you, especially if there's a shelf life, and most do, you should probably go for it. Mm-hmm. You know, like I don't think there's a lot of things that you really have to think through and that you figure out are bad. You know, there are some like that, but for the most part, there's mostly the really big decisions that you really need to go all in about and make a really critical decision.
Yeah, I know we've heard it before, but like kind of the idea of like, you know, act now, like, you know, the best time to start is today, not tomorrow, or is yesterday, whatever. I feel like recently I've been like seeing that and hearing that a lot, like, you know, it's been coming up, like start today, start now, like don't put things off. I think what you said, like, you know, when in doubt or like whatever, it kind of default to action. I think that's good.
Yeah. What are some other things that have a sort of shelf life, you know, like I'm trying to think some of the other scenarios, you know, of like practically for us that we can share, you know, I had, the opportunity with Barometrics, you know, like a new job change kind of just came out of nowhere. Mm-hmm. We've had things like, you know, you bought the businesses, and I think there's been other things I couldn't have invested in stock 10 years ago, but I invested in stock 5 years ago, and actually it hasn't been like crazy returns, you know? But what are the other things that have kind of a shelf life?
I was just thinking like investing in like RAs, stuff with like exponential returns. Like, you know, you have like that window before what, 25, they say, like if you don't invest, like, you know, you miss out on potential earnings you could have. Way off topic, but like dating, I think, you know, if you have a girl or a guy, whatever you've been talking to, whatever, and then kind of in the middle, like that's a shelf life. You got to make a decision, you know, yes or no. And I know I for sure have been in times where like, you know, definitely like mess that up, you know, but so that's hard, like kind of figuring out what do you want, going after and doing it.
Yeah. I mean, I think at a certain point, especially for relationships, like if you're not sure and you express that you're not sure, like that can almost be detrimental in a way, you know, and like, they're like, okay, cool. Like, I'm all in on you. Like, why aren't you on me? Mm-hmm. And what's happening? And then you can't really, like, if you don't really have a reason, you're like, I don't know, I'm just not there. It's like, cool, I guess they're not serious about me, or I guess it's not going anywhere. You know, I think that can happen a lot too with, you know, with people who date for a long time too, because I don't know exactly like why it's this way, but, I think when you're dating, right, there's, your relationship matures kind of at a steady pace, and basically you hit a certain like time, you know, let's say like it's like a year for some people, 2 years for some people, 3 years for other people. But basically there's at some point where like you've gone as far as you can, you're as close as you can get when you're dating. Okay. And the next step is you just need to get married to become closer. Mm-hmm. And that's just like, you've reached your peak. I know Monique and I kind of experienced this when we were engaged, because we were like so ready to be married. And when you're stuck in this place where like you're as close as you can get, but you're not as close as you could be and as you want to be, it's hard in a relationship and it's not fun. And there's a lot of people who like just let that, they just stay in that place, you know, and it becomes really unhealthy for relationship.
Mm. Yeah. What else thinking now?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think a lot of it, probably the big areas, right, are like business, relationships, and like job changes, are probably the big three. I'm sure there's other ones, but, or even like probably maybe like big purchases, buying a house, is probably another one. Like it's more sort of like an investment, although I'm not sure if houses are really an investment. A good purchase.
Easy.
Good purchase. Still go back and forth. I think I'm pro homeownership. I'm pretty sure.
You almost turned me over, but you didn't. You had so me, close. Bro, for a while. I was like, I'm going to rent forever.
No, it's not that anyways, that's another rabbit hole I have to go down another time. But I think that it's a good point. I mean, There's definitely some actionable things in there. I think, like you said, defaulting to action and like weighing the cost of like what's the upside versus the downside. Have that tight circle of people around you that you can go to. Or was that other things that you mentioned? Just kind of like wrap it up
and
summarize.
I think those are my main ones.
Yeah,
those two you just said.
Yeah. Okay.
This is, I don't know why I felt like it was cheesy when it came to my mind, but maybe it's not. So I want to say it. Like I was just thinking like all these things we're talking about. Yes, those all have a shelf life, but like I think one that doesn't have a shelf life that we don't talk about often is like coming to know the Lord. Like you know your faith, and I don't know why. Again, I'm not trying to be like sentimental and cheesy, but it came to my mind. I was like, oh,
no.
that's true. Like. That's one thing that, like, I think among anything else, like, that won't, like, expire, that won't run out, that's always available, you know?
Hmm. Yeah. I mean, like, life.
I mean, more than that, like, I guess, yeah, so coming to the Lord, but also just, like, I think turning from sin, like, if you know, and then you're, like, stuck in for a long time, like, that is one thing that no matter how far you go, no matter how long it lasts, like, yeah, there's consequences, like, in this life, but, like, you can, there's forgiveness, and, like, that, you know, that can be redeemed.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, that's a hard one because, you know, obviously the deeper you go into sin or the longer you're in sin, the harder it is to turn away. But also, like if you think of it as an opportunity to turn away instead of, like, an obligation, right? That opportunity, you have an opportunity to basically, like, minimize the damage being done for yourself or for someone else or for a relationship with God. And there's a lot of, I mean... The fact is, again, it's a little bit cheesy, but we have those opportunities every day. Mm-hmm. And like those have a shelf life. The day ends. And if you either made the right decisions or you turned away from sin or you didn't.
Yeah.
And, one of the other things I was thinking about was, like sort of, we got some good feedback on the will and motivation and I forget what we called it. The title. We always come up with the titles afterwards, so it's hard to think of it. But we got some good feedback on that. It made me think of like a lot of times we get like a spurt of motivation and like inspiration for something, and we're like we feel very like okay, let's just go do it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's usually the time where we kind of get scared and like oh well I shouldn't do it. I'll leave it till tomorrow. I'll do it next week. I'll do it next time next year. I don't know what it is, or I'm not ready yet. But really, like, you should kind of take those times where, especially when you're feeling motivated and you're feeling inspired, and, like, use that to your advantage. You know what I mean? Like, ride that wave until it goes. Because especially motivation, inspiration definitely has a shelf life.
Yeah.
Like, that stuff
for sure
goes like the wind, dude. It's just gone.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, that's probably the last thing we'll say. And, again, really off topic, but I think it's funny. In my family... anytime there's expired food or like whatever growing up, my mom was always like, oh, it's fine, just eat it. And like, that's always how she was. And I'm the type, like, if something is like barely expired, like I won't touch it.
If it's the day before, it's
already
expired.
I won't eat it. And, I haven't figured out that analogy yet, but I know that it's deep. I just wanted to say that.
Nice. Well, there's something
that one hits hard for sure.
Yeah,
so think about that one.
We'll let it simmer.
Yeah, it just came to my mind, so I'll think about it too.
Okay, cool.
Take us home, Corey.
Well, thanks again, everyone, for listening. If you have any thoughts or questions about this topic in particular, feel free to reach out. You can DM us on Instagram, Facebook, even Twitter if you want to go to our Cultivate and Keep handle. We do have a Twitter account, and actually it auto-posts every time. Every week we post an episode, so
nice.
If you want that easy way to keep in the loop, you can. Three things really quickly that we're working on. Working on the Cultivate and Keep merch. If you're interested, go to cultivateandkeep.com/merch. Working on the journal as well. I've been thinking about it a lot recently, actually, and I'm getting really excited about it. I think it's going to be a really cool thing. A 52-week-long journal, weekly kind of idea to help you run through some of the major themes that we talk about. If you're interested in that, go to cultivateandkeep.com/journal. And finally, we've got the private community and accountability group. If you're interested in that, go to cultivateandkeep.com/community. Cool.
Goodbye.
We will see you in the next one. Deuces.